My presentation today, the title of my presentation is Turkey's Place in the Early Attempts at European Integration. What I am going to discuss today, I am going to discuss the ideas of two leaders of the 1930s. One is Kudenhove Kalergi and the other one is Aristide Briand. And then I will also discuss what they thought about Turkey's place in Europe, in fact, in a project of a European Union. In the 1930s, Turkey was gradually brought into the European fold through participation in two significant projects. As I said, one was Kudenhove Kalergi's, the other one was Aristide Briand's. Richard Kudenhove Kalergi, as you see his picture there, coming from cosmopolitan background with an Austrian father and a Japanese mother, was born in the multinational and multi-ethnic empire of Austria-Hungary. In fact, his ideas inspired influential political leaders of the time, such as Aristide Briand, who attempted to launch a European Union within the framework of the League of Nations. Kudenhove Kalergi's pan-Europe, though initially excluded Turkey from the project, but later on included, as we will discuss, Turkey within it. In fact, I would like to say also that I will discuss also in the end of my presentation. Nobody knows this is the problem in Turkey, Kudenhove Kalergi. But he is the one who influenced all the other leaders of the who, in fact, contributed to the establishment of a European Union, such as Jean Monnet, Henri Despac, and others. Then, for the first time in 1923, Kudenhove Kalergi put forward the idea of a European Union in his book Pan-Europa. The weakness of the League of Nations led Kudenhove Kalergi to focus on the ideal of the United States of Europe in the early 1920s. His United Europe was defined politically rather than geographically or culturally. Geographically, there was no European continent, according to Kudenhove Kalergi. There was only a European peninsula of a European continent. For him, Europe was a political concept which embraced all the non-Soviet states of continental Europe. What remained of European Turkey belonged politically to Asia, according to him, in 1923. Again, in his book Pan-Europa, he wrote that the League of Nations was no substitute for Pan-Europe. So long as Germany did not belong to the League of Nations, there was a grave danger that Europe would fall, in fact, apart into two camps, the Geneva League and the Moscow League. As you know, when the League of Nations was founded, Germany was not first a member of the League. Germany became the member of the League, a member of the League, in 1926.
When was the UN founded? It was called something else, but...
Well, it was, they started the works in 1919, but it was, I think, officially published in 1920. Then he argued, in fact, it may someday happen that Germany, as well as Turkey, Persia and Afghanistan, will become members of the Militarist League of Moscow rather than of the Pacifist League of Geneva. Because at that time, as you know, Turkey as well as Germany, this was the Weimar Republic period, had close relations with the Soviet Union. Then the greatest obstacle to the realization of the United States of Europe, according to him, was a thousand years of rivalry between Germany and France. As you know, I mean, others also wanted to establish the European Union or at the first common market. Their main if a concern was to have reconciliation with Germany and France. This was the main idea. This rivalry could be placated only by joint European efforts. Therefore, Pan-European's main function will be to secure peace by creating a supranational structure, the European Federation. A federal union will prevent any inter-European war, neutralize Europe in world conflicts, protect Europe against invasion by red or white Russian troops. He also thought that disarmament would be possible in a federal union of Europe, and Europe will be able to compete with the American and British industries. Moreover, he believed that Pan-Europe will promote economic growth by creating a common market. Nationality problems in Europe will be diminished by means of both economic and political integration and democratic principles. As a result, borders will gradually lose, in fact, their significance. Now, this was in general the idea of Kudenhove, the ideas of Kudenhove Kalergi, who was, in my opinion, and for according to many people, the forefather for the, in fact, the formation of the European Union that exists today, intellectually. Then, on the other hand, there was also someone, a politician that we most of us know, Aristide Briand, who was at the time foreign minister of France, who also supported a European Union. In fact, became the honorary president of Kudenhove Kalergi's Pan-Europe movement. Briand, in fact, had been in the office since 1925 and became prime minister even in France in 1929. Briand's interest in a European federation can be linked to a number of factors. As a realist, he was concerned about French security. He believed that French interests would be best served if Germany could be linked to a European framework. Of course, this is different than other, you know, leaders' ideas at that time. And it was practical alternative to the Anschluss, because even, you know, when we think of Anschluss, many people think of, you know, Hitler and, you know, and Nazism, but the idea of Anschluss was already started being discussed at that time in the early 1930s. Then Briand was one of the few French leaders who wanted reconciliation with Germany. But also his socialist background led him to care for conciliation, arbitration, and peace. Finally, economics influenced Briand's orientation towards the idea of the European Union. He said, "You are going to find ourselves soon circled by two enormous powers, the United States and Russia. You see that it is indispensable to make the United States of Europe." During the 1927 World Economic Conference, Aristide Briand brought up the prospects for a European Economic Union with Stresemann, who was the foreign minister of Germany. By the way, this is the Aristide Briand in the middle, who is discussing the idea of a European Union. Then this is, as you see there, very Europe Nouvelle, towards a new Europe. And here, this is Stresemann, the foreign minister of Weimar Republic in Germany. And he was also favoring a reconciliation with France. Briand, in his address to the League of Nations in September 1929, called for the creation of a sort of federal link between the European nations. In contrast to Kudenhove Kalergi, Briand said, "I think that a sort of federal link has to exist between people geographically grouped like the European people." As we said before, Kudenhove Kalergi was against geographical union. Moreover, he was careful to emphasize that this thing will not jeopardize the sovereignty of any nation. In other words, it was to be flexible enough to respect the independence and national sovereignty of each nation. In May 1930, Briand published a memorandum concerning his idea on European Union. He also made clear that a federation will be built not upon the idea of unity, but of union. Moreover, Briand's memorandum made membership of the League a prerequisite for participation in the Union. Now, the big difference also between Coudenhove-Kalergi and Aristide Briand, Coudenhove-Kalergi excluded Britain from a European Union, but Briand supported that. But Coudenhove-Kalergi was right, because Britain immediately reacted negatively to such a project. In fact, British main concern was that these new European institutions will diminish both the efficiency and the authority of the organs of the League. At the same time, the British were also concerned that such initiative would undermine Anglo-Saxon economic domination. Yet the work of the idea of a European Union officially began in the form of Commission of Inquiry for European Union, and Aristide Briand was elected as a chairman. Well, these are, in general, these were the ideas of Aristide Briand. But Coudenhove-Kalergi, as an idealist, was disappointed by Briand's memorandum. He said, Briand rejected a European customs union and respected the sovereignty of all nations involved. It aimed at no European federation, but an effective League of Nations. It was a substitute, not the real thing. The realism of Briand and the idealism of Coudenhove-Kalergi clashed. Briand cared first about his country's security as a French political leader. As an intellectual, Coudenhove-Kalergi cared more about the interests of Europe as a whole. His idea of a European federation was to prevent new wars, to protect individuals against tyrants, and finally to prevent the hegemony of one European nation over the others. Briand believed that the collaboration of the three great powers, France, Britain, and Germany, was fundamental to the formation of a new order in Europe, whereas Coudenhove-Kalergi argued that the European Federation will prevent the hegemony of one European nation over others. As I said before, Coudenhove-Kalergi believed that if Britain became a member, it would prevent the union of European countries, since it had so many interests outside Europe. Britain and Russia, militarily and economically, were too strong, and they will challenge such a union. Then, Coudenhove-Kalergi, as a cosmopolitan intellectual, was also critical of nationalism. His ideal was a Europe without national frontiers. Unlike Briand, he believed that cultural nationalism was a menace to the European Federation. Related to that, the role of the League of Nations in this process had different meanings for Coudenhove-Kalergi and Briand. For the French leader, the League was to play the role of engine in the formation of a European Union. However, for Coudenhove-Kalergi, a European Federation was an alternative to the League, which was under British influence. Then these are, in general, the ideas of two leaders at that time. Now, in fact, I will discuss Turkey's changing place in the interwar proposals for a European Union. The two projects of European Union came around the time when Turkey was trying to break its international isolation. At that time, Turkey was not yet a member of the League of Nations. And on the domestic front, an ambitious modernization program had been initiated, as most of us know. When Kudenho Kalergi's Pan-Europa was first published in 1923, Turkey had just emerged as a sovereign state trying to build a nation and detach itself from the Ottoman past. Kudenho Kalergi's decision to leave Turkey out of his Pan-Europe was not a big concern for Turkey, because at the time, Turkish leaders were busy to stabilize both the domestic and the international situation. But leaders and intellectuals in Turkey disappointed by Briand's proposal, because Briand did not initially include Turkey among the 26 European countries which were invited to discuss his memorandum on the European project. Turkey was excluded from the project for two reasons. First, it was not a member of the League of Nations. Second, Turkey was not part of the geographical Europe as defined by Briand. Although Ankara was more attentive to Briand's initiative than London, Turkish intellectuals as well as statesmen remained skeptical about Briand's proposal, and particularly about inclusion of Britain. For Zeki Mesut, who was an eminent Turkish journalist and jurist of the time, Briand's project was a reflection of the imperialist and chauvinistic aims of the French Prime Minister Poincaré, Raymond Poincaré, who was seeking to divide the European nation. This is Poincaré's picture. The Turkish press criticized the way in which the French defined the borders of Europe. The Turkish press argued that for the French, the European border ended at the borders of France and those of its allies. Even though the French ignored it, according to the Turks, Turkey was geographically in Europe since it was bounded by two European seas, the Black Sea and the Mediterranean. Moreover, they argued that the values and norms accepted by societies were more significant than geographical criterion in defining Europeanness, which in any case was met by Turkey. For the ruling elite, to become part of a wider European project was a goal to be achieved. The Turkish leaders believed that Turkey should be part of any international initiative. Can you see Aras there in the middle? Turkish Foreign Minister Tevfik Rüştü Aras criticized the European Union project as being planned only for the continent. In his opinion, a harmonious international order could be established only if it included all nations which already had connections with each other in the small world. I mean, there in the next to Ms. Vatina, you can see with glasses, Şevket Rüştü. He was, in fact, the foreign minister of Turkey during the time of Atatürk. Ankara lobbied in several European countries, namely Italy, Germany, Greece, Hungary, and Bulgaria, that Turkey be invited to the deliberations on European Union. While Italy and Germany recommended the participation of both Turkey and the Soviet Union in the European Reunion project in their responses to Briand, Greece stood out as Turkey's principal sponsor. Italy, on the other hand, I have to mention, because Italy was playing an important role for Turkey, not in a good sense. Italy opposed to Briand's project because of its rivalry with France. Turkish leaders, because as I said, Italy said Turkey and the Soviet Union should be part of a European project. Turkish leaders and the press were not convinced that these two countries, France and Italy, were ready to give up their rivalry for the sake of a European Union. The Italians perceived the Briand proposal as an opportunity to capitalize on the increased sense of isolation in Turkey. In fact, Mussolini was working for a Turkish-Greek reconciliation that will lead to a tripartite alliance with Italy in order to compete with France in that region. Again, according to Zeki Mesut, the minds of European leaders were not even clear on what Europe was. For instance, he believed that for France, Europe meant Western Europe, while Germans and Austrians focused on Central Europe, and the Italians were interested in creating an Italian-led bloc in Europe. While Briand did not sound very enthusiastic about the participation of Turkey and the Soviet Union, according to Briand, the Commission was supposed to examine economic problems, as Britain desired, without giving an opinion on the admission for Turkey and the Soviet Union. At the end of deliberations in January 1931, the Commission invited Iceland, Turkey, and the Soviet Union to join. Briand in Geneva wrote to Paris that the French government hoped to see a positive response to this invitation from the Turkish government. This invitation can be regarded as a pragmatic move to prevent Turkey from drifting into the Italian orbit. The French were concerned about Italian manipulation of Turkey, even within the framework of the Commission of Inquiry for European Union. In its reply to the invitation, the Turkish government not only confirmed its participation, but also pronounced emphasis on the equality of all participant states. During the May work of the Inquiry Commission, discussions centered on purely economic rather than political issues. As I said, this was what, in fact, Britain wanted, but also because of the world economic crisis at that time. Turkish Foreign Minister Aras pointed out the dangers of confining economic cooperation to a limited number of states or to a particular region. Well, after the death of Aristide Briand in March 1932, the work of Inquiry Commission of European Union had lost its importance. In September 1932, Turkey was already a full-fledged participant in because it was already a member of the League of Nations. 2 weeks after Turkey's admission to the League, the French Parliament hailed Turkey's entry as moral and political event of extraordinary significance to Europe's interest. Now I want to discuss also shortly about Gudenhove Kalergi's ideas and about his second book, which is published in 1934. Compared to that of Aristide Briand, Gudenhove Kalergi's view of Turkey changed from 1923 to 1934. In his major work in Pan-Europa, which is published in 1923, Gudenhove Kalergi had regarded the new Turkey as a source of risk to the Balkan countries. But in the first half of the 1930s, Turkey was among the countries Gudenhove Kalergi visited in order to enlist allies for his struggle against Nazism. In 1934, Gudenhove Kalergi published his second book, Europe Awake, which rejected Nazi theories about nations being naturally given entities. In his book, Gudenhove Kalergi included Turkey along with the other Balkan countries within a political Europe. In fact, it was Mustafa Kemal Atatürk's reforms that led him to reconsider his view of Turkey. It was the Greek Prime Minister Venizelos who persuaded him that Turkey under the rule of Kemal Atatürk should be made a part of Pan-Europe. Gudenhove Kalergi wrote, "Venizelos assured me that Greece could only cooperate with our movement if Turkey were also included." Okay, this is the map in Europe Awake of Pan-Europa or Pan-European countries. And this is, as you see, pictures of Kemal Atatürk and Venizelos. As you know, at that time, Turkey and Greece formed with their initiatives, with mainly the initiatives of these two countries, formed the Balkan Entente. And Kudan Okalergi wrote that peace had been concluded between Turkey and Greece, thanks to the two far-sighted, energetic statesmen, Atatürk and Venizelos. These two statesmen concluded an alliance and hence laid the foundations of a Balkan Union. He argued that while the Franco-German reconciliation had stalled, the reconciliation between Greece and Turkey constituted a major success in the East in that respect. Okay, after discussing all this and emphasizing a lot on the ideas of Kudan Okalergi, and that's why, in fact, I wanted to do research on his ideas, there is no evidence that Kudan Okalergi's ideas on Europe were popular with the Turkish public. Hüseyin Cahit Yalçın's Fikir Hareketleri, which published translations of a number of works on the idea and spirit of Europe, did not carry a single reference to his pan-Europe vision. Furthermore, there is no record that his books were read by or placed in the personal library of Mustafa Kemal Atatürk. Then what could be the reasons? Of course, these are my, you know, in a sense, some conclusions. One reason of this non-interest was Kudan Okalergi's strong and unrelenting anti-Soviet stand. The Turkish leaders at that time were reluctant to be associated openly and deeply with anti-Soviet movement. This can be one consideration. The other one, Kudan Okalergi's conception of pan-Europe presented the new Turkish rulers with a dilemma regarding sovereignty. While Kudan Okalergi's pan-Europe called for participating states to make concessions from their sovereignty in somewhat supranational entity, the new republic was struggling to recover its sovereignty. Third consideration, pan-regions and pan-ideas did not have much of an appeal for Turkish leaders or the public because of their experiences during the First World War. Hence, pan-Islamism and pan-Turkism, with pan-ideas probably cast their shadows over the minds of Turkish leaders in shaping their perceptions and understanding of Kudan Okalergi's pan-Europe. Then to conclude, of these two, Turkish leaders and public could relate more effectively and more easily to Briand's European Union than Kudan Okalergi's pan-Europe for two reasons. First, Briand's proposal called for an intergovernmental setting, which was acceptable for the sovereignty-conscious Turks. Second, the Turkish state was seeking an organic presence in the European state system. Admission to the League of Nations was regarded as a way station to such an organic presence. In any case, the great rivalry in Europe secured Turkey a seat in the institutions of Europe during the interwar period. Now, on the ideational aspect of European integration, Kudan Okalergi's ideas did not have much influence even among the most ardent pro-European intellectuals of the time in Turkey. This lack of awareness and appreciation of Kudan Okalergi's pan-Europe has continued up to now. It may reflect a general failure to articulate the European Union as an ideal beyond its economic and political dimensions. The Turkish case, so far, stands in dark contrast to the experience of newcomers to the current European Union from the East and Central Europe, where Kudan Okalergi's utopia had been quickly rediscovered and frequently cited as a justification of such countries' claim for a place in the European Union. Then Kudan Okalergi and his pan-Europe remain to be rediscovered in Europe. Let me show you another Here, this is the Pan-European Movement Congress in 1932. If you have any questions or...
Where was that held?
Basel, I think, in... But it wasn't later on, anyway, this is the second one, the third one was not held because of Nazism, because of Nazis coming to power.
And Turkey was not there even as an observer?
No, in fact, Turkey was there.
Was there?
Yeah. Turkey, in fact, let me give you, I didn't mention this. In fact, Turkey sent Turkish, in fact, Ambassador Cemal Hüsnü and Cemal Hüsnü, in fact, in Switzerland, as Secretary Nedim Veysel to Bern, attended the Basel, in fact, this is the, that's right, Basel meeting in November 1932.
Just for curiosity, what happened to Kulen Kaya? Was he alive in 1938?
You know, he lived until 1972.
So did he remain in Austria?
No, in fact, during the Nazi regime, well, he lived in different, he lived in Austria, then he lived, you know, in Czechoslovakia. Then during the war, he went to the United States. And what is interesting, he had the support of this movement from many intellectuals such as Einstein and Freud.
In your judgment, what does the current European Union look like? Closer to Brian?
Well, maybe until the 1990s, rather like Brian's one, because it was mainly economic, you know, common market that we call. But now there are attempts, since it's European Union, there are attempts to form really a union of European countries at all level. But there is also another, as Zeki Mesut says, I mean, still, this is my own, you know, idea that I don't know if really European leaders know what Europe is. This is, I mean, the same thing is even true for today. I mean, because for French, it's something at all. For Sarkozy's France, it's something else. For Merkel's Germany, it's something else. Or for the British, something different. But what interests me most that Turkey was never, and Turkish leaders still are, never interested in the ideational, you know, aspect of European Union. This is what, you know, most Eastern European countries did, such as Poland, for example.